So once again, good morning. My name is Iwan van Beurden, and today we will be talking about how we can account for batch operation in SIL verification. I say good morning because I am on the US East Coast in the Philadelphia area, and it's a beautiful sunny day outside. I hope it's sunny wherever you are. And as I said, if we have any questions, feel free to type those in. So again, my name is Iwan van Beurden. I'm the CTO, Director of Product Development here at Exeda. I support our end user services, as well as our manufacturer services and our certification activities. I'm responsible for the Exelentia software and the maintenance certification of it, as well as the SILSTAT live event recording component that falls under the Exelentia umbrella. I'm a member of the US National Committee, part of the maintenance team for IEC 61511, a member of ISA 84. There's a variety of activities that I perform, and I am a ISA fellow. I assume that most of you are familiar with Exeda, but just a little bit of background. Exeda is founded on three different pillars that represent our basic focus areas. We have a group of individuals that is very active in the certification and assessment area. So you'll see many products that are certified to IEC 61508, for example, or the IEC 62443 standard, as well as the Certified Functional Safety Expert program that is all handled by this certification team. Then we have a group of individuals that are active in the lifecycle services, our engineering component. We provide advisory services as well as engineering services to support your projects. And then the third group is the innovation team. That's where we develop the Exelentia software, our product team, as well as some of our publications, our books, for example. Though there are three individual pillars, there's good synergy between the different pillars. Engineering consultants will use our software tool. The OEM team performs analysis on products. The failure rate information, as well as the certification levels of those components, will all feed back into the Exelentia software, for example. So it's a nice synergy between the different pillars. We have offices around the world, as you can see here. And as I mentioned, I'm in the Philadelphia area. If you can see my cursor on the screen, that is right around here. And obviously we have variety of offices with different focus areas. In some cases, our colleagues in Germany are very active in the automotive industry, for example, just to name one aspect. For process owners, we provide complete solution, ranging from alarm management to cybersecurity, functional safety, obviously, as well as the enterprise tools that support all these three different areas. Today, I'll primarily focus on the functional safety aspect because we're looking at how we can account for batch in SIL verification. So let's look at what is batch. What is a batch operation? And what do you do when you try to find, how can you best explain what a batch operation is? You look at definitions. And definition that you can see here is for batch process. That comes from the NCISA 84 standard that was published in 1995. I purposely took an old version of the standard, basically to indicate there's nothing really new on batch. We've known batch processes for a while. I'll just talk about the verification aspects of it. So, a batch process is defined as a process that leads to the production of a finite quantities of material by subjecting quantities of input materials to an ordered set of processing activities over a finite period of time using one or more pieces of equipment. Process runs for a limited time. We make a limited number of quantities. Those are a couple of takeaways there. We can also look at another definition on batch operation, and this was published by Sutton in the Process Risk and Reliability Management second edition book. And it's defining batch operation as one in which the operating conditions change over time. Typically, a series of steps are followed. The product is transferred to the next phase of the operation and the process starts over. Again, it's that shorter period of time. We move the product over and we start again. Limited quantities, limited time. There's a second statement in that particular publication that says the distinction between continuous and batch operations is not as great as is sometimes thought. All steady state processes include a variety of batch operations, such as filling tanks from trucks and catching samples according to a predetermined schedule. Moreover, the sequence of instructions within the procedure or module is essentially the same as the sequence of instructions in a batch process. And the interesting part here is that I got an email from a customer probably 45 minutes ago that talked about filling tanks around 100 times a year. And, you know, limited period of time, you know, should we consider that a batch process? How do we handle the seal verification? So, as you can imagine, I forwarded a link to this webinar. I said, we're going to talk about that. But that's an example of a batch process. You know, even though it may be a continuous process where, you know, material from a storage tank goes into the next phase of the process, that tank needs to be filled up, and that may happen through tanker trucks and therefore become becomes a more, you know, a batch type process. But what we see is limited quantities, a limited time. And, you know, that kind of brings us to the operating cycles. And if we assume that we have a system that runs for 10 years, you know, continuous operation in the ideal world, we start it up, it runs, and then after 10 years, we shut it down, assuming that that's our operating window. And for a batch process, that's going to look completely different. That's going to be on, off, on, off, on, off, on, off. And yes, the chart on the right-hand side looks a little bit messy, but that was obviously on purpose because, you know, I want to show that that's one of the big differences between your continuous operation and batch. So what can we conclude out of that? In a batch scenario, the hazard may not always be present when the process is offline. Now, this is something that's important for you to verify that is actually the case. It is important to, you know, if you talk about a storage tank and there's material in that tank, you know, even though your process may not be running all the time, that material is in the tank. So if there's a hazard associated with the material in the tank, that, you know, that may not necessarily be a batch process from a safety perspective, because the stuff is always there, even though your process is only running for a couple of months a year. But if the hazard is not always present, then you know, that's something we can take into consideration. Startup and shutdown occur a lot more frequent, and in the past during PHAs, often when we were looking at a continuous process, the startup and shutdown periods were not studied that thoroughly because the majority of the time we were going to be in operation. Obviously, we learn from accidents, and a lot of things happen during startup, shutdown, maintenance. So, you know, definitely if accidents facilitating the PHA will spend a lot more focus on that than was traditionally done. But for a batch process, it's definitely important to look at because the startups and shutdowns happen very frequently. Brings in an opportunity, and that is the opportunity of test more frequent. At the end of a batch, if the valves are either open to transfer the product, or if the valves are closed to stop flow into a reactor, we're exercising the valves. We have the ability to look at these strokes. And in the past, sometimes I would recommend just to consider it a partial stroke. Your actual full stroke would give you more credit than the partial test. But that's something that we may want to take into consideration here as well. So we have some options. As I mentioned earlier, batch is nothing new, right? We've had batch for a while. And in 2001, we actually published a study on safety and batch production. And we primarily focused at that point at different trip point settings and recipes that were being used in batch operation and how they would change from one phase to the next and how that would impact potential trip points. And yes, I got some confirmation here that the audio works from other people. So thank you very much for confirming that. So we've been dealing with batch for a while, and if we talk to our marketing people, they will probably be rolling their eyes right now, seeing this particular old Exeda.com logo. That's kind of how we started in the early 2000s. We had internet-based tools. The Excellentia software was an internet-based tool only. We had resources online. The internet was, I don't want to say new, but not as advanced, obviously, as it is nowadays. You can't do a thing without the internet. Since we've dropped the .com aspect, but some of you that may have followed Exeda for a long time, this may bring back memories. Often, when we look at our layer of protection analysis, we can take into account a use factor. We can take into account the period during which the batch process is not running. And in this example, we have an enabling condition, and that enabling condition has a probability of failure or a probability of 0.5, or in other words, 50% of the time this particular batch is running and 50% of the time it's not. So we can take that into account, and we should only do that, of course, if all the initiating event frequencies and other probabilities of failures are based on continuous operation. Otherwise, we would be double dipping. But that's a way that we can account for batch in the LOPA aspects of the safety lifecycle. So how does it work in SIL verification? What are the things that we want to look at during SIL verification? Obviously, testing. We talked about that. But what else? So I already mentioned that if your safety function is not expected to protect against a hazard scenario when the batch is offline, so in this example, the reactor is empty, then during that period of time, the probability of failure is equal to zero. During that period of time, we're not relying on the SIF to provide protection, so it cannot feel dangerous. So that is something that is, that we can take into consideration. If the batch is offline and the SIF is not protecting against a hazard scenario, it cannot fail. Probability of failure is zero. We already talked about this one, where the feeding into and emptying reactors, we will be exercising our finite elements a lot more frequent than we do in a continuous operation, where things just keep on flowing and there's not the extra action of stop, feed into the reactor, open the valve to get the product out, and so on. And in the past, often we would account for this through, let's say, partial stroke testing. We'd say, yes, we are stroking the valve completely, but if we assume that we only do a partial stroke, we're going to assume that we're going to, be less effective than we really are, which is a conservative approach, which is perfectly fine. But this is something that we can take into consideration. However, and this is a tricky one, a lot of our equipment, transmitters, logic solvers, but even our valves, fine elements, they are still being exposed to the same stressors that they would be exposed to if the process is up and running. So if we have external temperatures or humidity aspects or other, you know, shock, vibration, etc., that are all, you know, combined the stress on the equipment, those stresses still exist even though the hazard is not present. So our equipment can still fail. So what that means is, in your traditional in your traditional probability of failure graph, you see the probability of failure on time continuously increasing. What this means is the probability of failure will also increase if the system is shut down. We're not providing any protection, so we account for a probability of failure equals zero, but the starting point for the next batch is going to be higher than the endpoint of the previous batch. So how are you going to handle that? And I see a question here, and I'll answer that in a little bit. The easy answer is the silver tool can take care of it. What you see here is a probability of failure on, as a function of time, for a hypothetical batch process. It runs for a month and it's 2 months offline. It runs for a month, it's 2 months offline, and so on. And obviously the red line is the probability of failure as a function of time. The black dotted line is our average probability of failure. That is calculated over the mission time. In this example, it's 10 years. And the probability of failure is zero in between the batches. The probability of failure is zero during the time that the hazard is not present. And that's that's what we see right here. We don't really see it on the log scale because the log scale doesn't have zero, but the other thing that you can see here is the one right above it, that the probability of failure at the start of the next batch is higher than the probability of failure at the end of the previous batch. So I think my cursor is easier because I can pinpoint it. You can see here this probability of failure is higher than this probability of failure. And for the first one, it's even a bigger jump. And that refers back to that, the probability of failure is going to continue to increase because the equipment is exposed to the same stresses, even when the SIF is not really providing any protection. We can take into account a test at the end of each batch. In this particular example, I did not do that because I wanted to show that difference between the starting point and the end point from a probability failure perspective. So if we would account for a test at the end of the batch, then obviously we would be at a lower point here. We would start up, which would seem to be a lower point, but it would still take into consideration that that the equipment can fail during during the time where the SIF is not protecting. So that is an easy way for me to say, hey, that's how silver takes care of it. So let's see what this would look like in silver. And I originally planned to do a demo, but in this morning's webinar, whenever I launched Excellentia, GoToWebinar wasn't too happy. So there seemed to be some frame buffering going on that is not really happy with GoToWebinar, and unfortunately I've seen it previously. So I've taken some screenshots since, and we will be looking at the screenshots. But we're going to look at some of the parameters that we can specify and what it does on the probability of failure, both on SIF level and group level. So first, if we open up Excellentia We could get a SIF that looks like this one here, where I have a 2 out of 3 voting over 3 temperature transmitters. Think of the temperature in the reactor going to a reactor PLC and then operating, in this case, 2 valves in series. So let's say that's my feed into the reactor, the inlet valves, and I have 2 valves in series. Everything that you can see here is you know, as you are familiar with, but with the release of Excellentia 4.11, which we did at the end of the first quarter of 2021, so a little over a month ago, we provided this option here that says batch operation. And that is, you know, that's new. And I can check that box. And if I do that, I will be able to specify a batch duration as well as a time between batches. So I can, you know, specify how long does my batch take and how much time is there between batches. And, you know, that could lead to a diagram just like this. So in this case, we're running for 20 years. The diagram on the left is my continuous operation scenario. We see the probability of failure is increasing as a function of time. After 5 years, apparently we do a proof test. You know, it continues to increase. After 5 years, we do a proof test and so on. And we can calculate the average probability of failure in the month. And we have our achieved SIL level with our achieved risk reduction. If we use that same system, and the only thing in this case that that we're accounting for is the fact that the SIF is not always active, the fact that the batch runs for a month and then it's 2 months offline, it runs for a month, it's 2 months offline, you know, we get the diagram that you can see on the right-hand side and a achieved SIL level that's a little bit higher, which obviously makes sense because now we're accounting for a period of time where the probability of failure is equal to zero because we're not protecting against the hazard. So that is an example of how the batch process would change your PFD chart with you know, those parameters that we just looked at. Yes, we run a batch operation. The batch takes a year, and we it takes a month, and then we shut down for 2 months. So that's what we can do in Excellentia now. Well, there's some other functionality. So we can, for example, say that at the end of the batch, we want to run a test. And we can enable the test, yes or no. And in this case, this looks at the sensors. We can see the 2 out of 3 voting. We can see the temperature selections, temperature measurement selections. As you can see, is we can make this choice. Do we want to run this test at the end of the batch, yes or no? Different choices for the sensors, the logic solver, and the fine elements. So in this case, we'll say, no, well, we're not really going to test the sensors. The sensors are just measuring the temperature. And yes, the temperature will go down if the batch is not running, but we continue to measure temperature. We're not really going to do any testing. The batch proof test interval calculator here shows us how many batches we can do within the proof test interval. So you will be able to account for this group maybe being part of a batch process as well as of a continuous process. So maybe we're measuring temperature in the reactor as one safety function and temperature in the reactor during the batch as a second safety function. So anyway, we can determine how frequent the batches are compared to this proof test interval. In this case, we can see that we can run 20 batches in between the proof test interval. So that's another item that we can see here. And then if we would go to the fine elements, in this example here, I added the end of batch tests for the fine elements. And I specified a pretty high coverage so we could see the effect, especially here on the left-hand side, we can see that, you know, the probability just drops and the achieved risk reduction factor goes up. It's a little bit difficult to see in the chart, but you can see the spikes here. So we're doing this end of batch test at the end of 1 year. I did that on purpose so you can see the difference. But that's the end of batch test that we can take into consideration in the Silver tool. Very straightforward, and you know, by looking at the PFD chart, which you can look, you know, click on the PFD button in the header of the worksheet, you can see the behavior as a function of time. There's a question here. So does the frequency of demand and the load on SIF increase when running under batch operation compared to continuous operation? How does it affect, if any, the SIL verification? So this is a good question. It kind of goes into, let me see if this chart may be, it may help. Well, actually, sorry, this chart may be better. So it kind of goes into the, you know, what's the demand mode of this safety function now that I run it in a batch application. So you could argue that by running it in a batch application, in this case, you know, I'm exercising those valves in this example 4 times a year. And you know, if we stick to IEC 61511, it says the demand on the SIF more frequent than once a year, that's a high demand or continuous demand application. Otherwise, it's low demand. So the question then becomes, is that, you know, is that becoming a high demand or continuous demand application? Well, I would argue it really depends on the frequency at which the safety instrument or function is asked to protect against a hazard scenario. And even though we're running in the batch example here, let's say this is the filling of my tanks as a function of time. I can fill my tank, let's say, once a month. And you could argue, well, that's 12 demands a year. But is that really a demand on the safety function? Or is there a control function that protects against this particular, that controls this filling and therefore protects against the overflow? If the control function is there, then sure, the activity may happen 12 times a year or maybe 100 times a year. The control function failing is what would cause a demand on my safety function. So if the control function, frequency of failure is once every 10 years, then the demand on my safety function is going to be once every, 10 years. It's not going to be once every fill, because, you're only responding with the safety instrument function if the control function. If there's no control function, but there's an operator taking action, then you need to take into consideration how often will the vessel not have enough space? Has the operator been trained? And based on that, you can calculate what the frequency is of the demands on the SIF versus the actual action. Closing the valves doesn't necessarily put a demand on the safety function. You can just consider that a test that we do with the equipment. If the control function and protection function are the same, then yes, there's a different story. Then we need to, then we're not talking about an independent protection function. Then we need to look at it, and we may indeed have a high demand or maybe even a continuous demand function, simply as a result of the SIF not being separate from the control function. So in everything I said before this, so this was another comment that came in, everything that I said before this, I was really focused on the SIF being an independent protection layer from the control function. If they're the same, then obviously every time that I'm controlling, protecting an overfill, my tank, then every time that will be a demand on your SIF, and you could look at the high or continuous demand applications.
Someone here is asking for a formula. Sorry, that will be intellectual property. But from the chart here, you can kind of see what is happening as a function of time. All right, so there are some more questions, but I'll continue and then I'll go back to some of the questions here. So let's look at what we can do in Silver. In Silver, we can calculate for batch intervals as low as a day. We can have time between batches as low as one day. That may not be adequate in some cases. Some cases we may need to go in the lower time intervals than that. And we can absolutely support that from an Exeter perspective. Wouldn't be done through the Exelentia software at this point. But just look at some examples. Our local grocery store here, one of the local grocery stores is Giant. And in Giant, we have Marty. And Marty is this autonomous robot that is roaming through the store and that is trying to identify spills and trash. And then when it finds a spill or trash, it will announce that and ask for someone to come and clean it up. So when we look at that, there are a couple of additional states that we may want to take into consideration. For example, Marty cannot run 24/7. He needs to go back home and charge. And that's what you see on the right-hand side of this picture. That's the charging station. So Marty goes to a couple of different states throughout the day. He may be charging. He may be running a self-test before he goes out and walks to the store. He may be, in Marty's case, he's not really cleaning, but he's announcing there is a spill, but we also have autonomous cleaning robots now that would be cleaning, and so on. So there's a couple of extra cycles and states that we may need to consider, and we may have multiple of those throughout the day. What are we going to do if Marty has an issue? What if Marty says, hey, I cannot move anymore? Well, that is a stay in place. But what if Marty says, my sensor doesn't work anymore? Is he going to stay in place? Is he going to go home and charge and run a self-test and try and fix himself? Those are different failure behaviors that we may need to take into consideration. And then there's something that's the demand frequency. Now, when Marty roams through the store and I'm doing groceries, Marty is going to have a kit jump in front of him many a times because I would like to see if he really detects people. Now, you could call it a test of the sensing system or just an annoying person, but those are things that we need to take into account. And that may require a bit more detailed analysis, with time intervals going as low as minutes or seconds, that the Silver tool as of now does not support. Low as is a day. Another example is a mining elevator. And in the earlier session, someone identified, well, these things would fall under the IEC 62061 or ISO 13849 standards, and then I'm not arguing against that. But if we would want to model how a mining elevator works over a day, there's different states that we need to take into consideration. Number of shifts, movement per shift, personnel versus or, what is being used, fall detection response, stay in place, run degraded if we have redundancy, and how often do we see a demand on the safety function? Is it part of the control loop or is there a separate function. In older elevators, or actually if you look at a amusement park and look at a roller coaster, when you go up the hill, you hear click, 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 click. Every time there's this safety mechanism that prevents you from going backwards as you're being dragged up that hill. So they may be completely independent. There may be an overlap between control and safety as we talked about with the filling of the tanker truck. And just for nostalgia. The pictures here are from my hometown. The lower end, the lower right hand corner, that's the original mine area in my hometown in Canicata. But all that was basically demolished by the time I was born, except this one building that is still in existence to this day, and is a national monument now in Holland. So anyway, that was 5 minute walk from where I lived. So I used the opportunity to show you pictures of my hometown. But going back to our batch scenarios, other things to take into consideration: autonomous forklifts, automated warehouses. Look at the Discovery Channel. Sometimes you see these warehouses with the robots that are packing stuff. They're 13 stories high or whatever, and it's all wonderful. But it has different safety functions, different behavior, not as trivial in some cases as the reactor example that I showed earlier. Accident can help with those, but things to take into consideration during normal operation. The unit may be charging, it may perform a self-test, and then may start cleaning or operating. And then there's a cycle that it will, it will bring back over and over. But what if a failure occurs? And in this case, I only considered a failure during the cleaning state, not really a failure during the self-test, which should cause a repair. Now, what if the failure is that the sensor is no longer working? Well, if the sensor stops working and it goes into, hey, there's something in front of me, don't move. Okay, that is a stay in place result. I'm not moving anymore, I have to repair it. If it's the sensor doesn't detect anything anymore, well, if I reveal it as part of a proof test, similar as a proof test, I could repair it. But if I don't detect or reveal that failure, that could be an issue, and I could have an accident. And that could mean the end of life of the particular unit, because it's going to be stored in an evidence room to be used for legal purposes later. So those are all different kinds of things that we can take into consideration with a bit more advanced modeling. There are some other aspects to take into consideration related to batch operation. One of those is alarm management. Different states in the batch may have different consequences to consider, may have different alarm set points, and may have different priority levels. And obviously, Accident can help with services, but our SilAlarm module, as part of the Accidentia suite, also supports these different alarm states. So that is something that you can take into consideration when you're doing your alarm rationalization. There's obviously a cybersecurity aspect. Whenever we're changing our recipes or we're changing our trip points, there's communication between the safety system and the control system. And if someone gets in that control system, they may mess up the trip points. They may be able to cause a problem with our system. So a high level cyber risk assessment would be very useful for those kinds of scenarios. And again, this is one of the services that we provide, and we can also support through our CyberFax and CyberSL tool that have been on the market for quite a while now. So those are all things that you should take into consideration. I see there are some people with issues connecting, but I also see that they got back on. So I hope that everybody is fine now. So kind of wrap this all up. There's a variety of advisory and engineering services that we can provide, from benchmark studies to detailed seal verification for batch processes. We've released this functionality, the batch modeling, in Exalentia 4.11, which was released at the end of quarter one of 2021. So it is something for you to consider and play with. So I have a question here, and I have the example on the tank filling. So let's say as an example, we have a tank that is being filled once every 3 days, so roughly 100 times a year. And the question is, is that a low demand safety function then? Let's say that I have an independent sieve that is protecting against overfill, in addition to a control function that is doing the actual control of the filling exercise. In that case, most likely, we would have to look at all the details, but most likely it would be a low demand safety and cementer function, because the control system, is making sure that there are no overfills. You would only have a demand on the sieve if the control function runs out of control. If there is, and which on average would happen once every 10 years. So in that case, it would indeed be a low demand sieve. If there is only one function that is, let's say, just a shut off function, there isn't really a control, then it comes to how often is the tank filled, who is filling it, how often is there a tank that doesn't have the capacity of the tanker truck. And then we get into a bit more detailed LOPA scenario where we look at all these different initiating events, and we can then determine the frequency of demands on the sieve. So how often is the tank not full or doesn't have enough capacity, and how often are we supplying, and what if the operator is trained or not trained? And it could become a more continuous or high demand function. But it's something that we'd have to look at in that particular case. Do you have to use the batch feature? You can. It's a function that we have provided. You could consider, instead of, if I go back to my tank filling, let's say I do it 100 times a year, you could say, well, instead of accounting for periods of where the sieve is not active, I'm just going to account for the fact that the sieve always needs to be active. That will be conservative, and you wouldn't go through the extra batch actions. So the question really is, do we need to account for batch process, yes or no? Or can we just assume that it's a continuous process if the sieve is a low demand, right? So if the sieve is a separate protection layer from the control system, do we have to account for batch process? You do not. You can, which will give you benefit of accounting for periods where the probability of failure is zero, which gives you the benefit of accounting for extra tests, if you want to take that credit, but you don't have to. You could just simply say, I'm going to assume this is a continuous process. It's a conservative assumption. But at the same time, we have one customer, they ran a batch for 3 months, once a year. So they had 9 months of inactivity following a batch, and then another 3 months, and then 9 months of inactivity. That's a scenario where it may make sense to take it more into consideration, because you don't have that frequent on off continuously throughout the year. Let's see, there's a couple more questions here. Not sure if I'm going to be able to answer all of them. So we talked about the formula, and I don't have a simplified formula apart from the IP aspect. I don't have a simplified formula for this, for the simple reason, and I can go back to our PFD chart. the original one, this one. I personally don't really know how to account for this increasing of probability of failure after a test in a simplified equation. It's very trivial in a Markov model. I would have to give it a bit more thought than just writing a POP formula down. So that's one of the reasons why it makes it very easy to account for it in solver, and maybe not as trivial in simplified equation. There is a comment here with regard to this goes back to the continuous mode. So each time when the SIF is inactive, the process is inactive, the SIF may still, the equipment may still be energized, but it's not really protecting. We consider that the probability of failure is zero. Does that make it a continuous mode function? No, it's still based on how often is there a demand on the safety function. So that isn't, and diagnostics, running exercising diagnostics and exercising equipment isn't necessarily a demand on the SIF. How do we address the safety from one batch to another batch, including cleaning cycles between batches? So that's a very good question, and that I'd almost say that starts with your PHA. So where I said at the beginning, we tend to overlook the startup and shutdown phases in a continuous mode system, because the majority of the time we're up and running. So in the PHA we tend to focus on that. Still, a lot of accidents happen during startup, shutdown, and maintenance. So these are definitely important phases to consider. If you're talking about a batch, obviously you will be way more focused on the on-off aspects of the system. But to the point here is how do you handle the cleaning cycles? So there's a couple of different things going on there. So these are different phases within your overall process that you definitely need to consider doing your PHA. Not all of them may have automatic protection capabilities. So if I am protecting against an exothermic reaction in the reactor, and I have some temperature measurements going on, or maybe I'm looking at that agitator, and making sure that the agitator keeps moving, any function based on those measurements would not really be effective when I'm cleaning. So there's different phases, and there may be different ways that we need to protect against particular hazards that are present during those phases. So I think that would definitely be going back to the PHA and the analysis of your process to make sure that you understand all the phases. And cleaning is depending on how the cleaning is done, but if an operator, engineer, or maintenance person has to go into an enclosed space, that has different risks associated with it that we would need to take into consideration. And not all of them we may have an automatic protection function for, that would then basically be going back to the PHA. So I think I've addressed the majority of the questions. And there's still a couple more, but we're kind of running out of time. So what we'll do is we'll address those questions afterwards. The webinar team will be sharing all the questions that have been asked with myself, and then we will We will answer those directly. If you want to try Excellentia, if you have access to it, then obviously go ahead. If you want to try it, feel free to sign up for a free trial on our website. Just go to excellentia.com. If you have any questions, feel free to raise those through our support website, support.exa.com, or send an email to info@exa.com. There's a variety of social media that we're active on. This recording will be posted on YouTube. I don't know exactly how long that's going to take before that's posted, but expect it in the next couple of days. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to myself or to your local Exa representative. And with that, I appreciate everybody dialing in to this webinar. Thank you very much, and stay safe. Bye-bye.